I think at least two occasions in the press where he admitted to being gay. But they don't really, I mean, it's there in black and white, but people don't pick on it. They haven't picked up on it.
You don't acquiesce or deny, or I think you just.
Come into my life, it's a man-made paradise.
He was a youngster today, a young 30-year-old, 40-year-old. It wouldn't bother him, you know, because things have changed so much over the years. Which I suppose in a way he did, yeah, played his part.
I'm not scared of doing what I want to do. Before I'd sort of hide in my past, like when I went out, I had to sort of try and perform a little as well and say, like, not letting them down and the thing of like, because Freddie Mercury, I don't know what it means, but he had to react in a certain way, what the press had told people. And a lot of the times I used to do that so that I was actually living, in a way, living a false image of myself, you know, and now I'm not worried. So, I mean, if I make a fool of myself, you know, if I fall into a dustbin, which I have many times, I don't worry about the fact that. And so I'm having a good time.
I suppose every gay person that don't really want their parents to know. Well, they do, but I mean, it's hard to actually break the news to them.
I think if they knew who was gay, I don't think it would have really made much difference. I don't think he needed to tell them.
I think he knew, the general public knew.
In his later years, Freddie returned to a life of monogamous domestic bliss, shared this time with Jim Hutton, who he used to introduce to people as his husband.
There was excess in every direction. I was extremely promiscuous. Well, that's true. But I stopped all that. I stopped having sex and started growing tulips.
The gay scene is so flippant anyway, and I suppose there comes a time in everyone's life and say, well, I have to settle down.
I just can't believe it's true.
I wanted a kind of genuine tranquil after the storm. But finding that wonderful person is very hard. There is this kind of sort of solace which I've got. It's like I don't have to try so hard. I don't have to prove myself hard. I've got a very understanding relationship. I mean, it sounds so boring.
He used to get a little bit irritated with me sometimes also, you know, the things like his cats. And of course, the cats would more often than not come to me instead of him. He used to get a little shirky about that. But I suppose at the end of the day, yes, he would probably say, well, fine, yes, I've got somebody at home to go home to. So, you know, no matter where you are, you've always got, once you've got someone to come home to, I suppose you feel more secure.
I'm very happy with my relationship at the moment. And I couldn't ask for better. So I finally found a niche that I was looking for all my life. And no fucker in this universe is going to upset it.
I do like to think, I mean, his last years were as happy as they could have possibly ever been.
It's so you. You're the one that's burning me upside down and up. So you're the one running hot and cold.
Though Freddie had a background in fashion design, he turned to professional help for stage costumes. Diana Mosley's creations would eventually give rein to his fantasies. But when in 1973, Queen needed outfits for their Olympia concerts, he and Brian showed up at Zandra Rhodes' loft.
I'd made clothes previously for T-Rex. And so maybe they'd seen those.
In the early days for Freddie, there was still this search of image.
Freddie was a free thinker, because, I mean, if you look at the whole transition and the different ways that he changed looks, I think that shows a wonderful free spirit.
He wanted black nail varnish, and he would shop, and had a quite a, somehow overnight had this clear idea of what he was going to wear and why.
She brought out all the materials and said, you could have a bit of this, bit of this, you know, and she said, I see you as something, you know, rather big and you know, very dramatic and flowing.
The very first costume that I did for Freddie was like a little tiny, narrow, rather ethnic bodice, and then wonderful fan pleating so that he could lift his arms.
That's only you.
He fits in with glam rock and definitely not with punk.
They had a little bit more magic, not so much in your face as the glam rock movement. They were a little bit, perhaps a bit more fairy tale like, perhaps a bit gentler.
I made fairy tale clothes for Princess Diana and rather wonderful flights of the imagination for Freddie Mercury, because he was bridging that gap from, first of all, going through that whole thing of being very made up, one of the first people to do that, to do the whole butterfly thing, then going through to the economy of another look. So it's rather exciting that he went through so many different changes.
It's so you. You're the one that's burning me upside down.
The only thing in fashion that you can rely on is the fact that it changes. And I was just one of the changes, but a very glamorous one.
In 1984, Freddie hired Dinah Mosley to style the video for I Was Born to Love You, and she went on to dress the Magic Tour and organise Freddie's private wardrobe and public costumes.
Born to Love You was going to have nothing but women in, no men. We're going to have 1,000 only, and he ended up with 300, but this one he was their warrior. It was his love song. So I dressed him in white. White and silver, but he was a sort of Romeo. Want of a better word, with the battle jacket on. Freddie wasn't into as people might have thought. He would dress properly for the right occasion, but he wasn't a complete fashion addict. Hey! With the Magic Tour, the one thing we sort of hooked on, or got everyone to think about, was white. Using that, because it's so fantastic for lighting in the big stadiums, and it means that the guys right at the back get to see something. One man, one goal. One mission, one heart, one soul. But I remember Freddie on that occasion phoning up from Sweden, where they did their opening nights on the tour. It isn't working. We need something else. I've got to do something, and I've had this idea. The others don't like it, but I want to do it. I want a crown, and I want a cloak with the ermine in. And all I said to him, I said, do you want this crown of metal, as sort of as real as we can make it? And he said, yes, that was it. So I suppose that's what Freddie liked. I picked up on what he was talking about very quickly and was true to it.
They went over the top a few times, and alarming lapses of taste.
Some of it might not have been in good taste, but it was always done tongue-in-cheek.
Freddie's attempts to imbue rock music with elements of opera were scorned by the rock press. The classical world, however, took his ambitions much more seriously, and on several notable occasions, he got to realise his dreams.